So, Prash, can we start?
Yes, you can start. Yeah, it is already recording started. Yeah.
Okay, sir. So, welcome back, everyone. After the wonderful overview that you have got about what we can do with virus sequence data, we'll be having a small demo of carrying out multiple sequence alignment as well as the phylogeny using a maximum likelihood, which is an alignment-based method, and RTD. So the first starting point is either you generate the sequence data in your own lab, or if you're interested in analyzing what is already available, we go to any of the known public genome, public nucleotide repositories. Here I've taken an example of GenBank. So what we would be doing is, say, suppose you're interested in retrieving the sequences pertaining to a particular virus. For example, if you're interested in retrieving the sequences pertaining to dengue virus. So these are this is an way you can formulate it. ORGN stands for organism. And if you're interested in any specific gene, you can give the name of the gene. For example, if I'm interested in retrieving the complete genome, we can formulate such queries using AND, OR NOT operators. Okay, and we can retrieve the data. So it says there are around 4,816 records. If you are aware of what the typical genome length of dengue virus genome is, you can always limit it by the genome length. This is because even though the nomenclature is complete genome, sometimes few of the UTR regions are usually found to be missing. And suppose you're interested only in analyzing the wild type isolate. So when I give a general query like this, we may have the vaccine strains sequenced. And if you're going to use such vaccine strains or some isolates which have been heavily passaged, then when you're using that for evolutionary analysis, it may not be very clean. Why? Because as you know, passaging inserts a lot of variations, and this may give a wrong observation that this sequence is very highly evolved as compared to others. So if you're interested only in wild type isolates, you should be using queries such as not vaccine, okay, so that you eliminate the vaccine things and not passage, etc. So these are just some general tips because when we give such generic things, see, automatically when I added these two queries to that, when I say I want complete genome, but they should not be the vaccine things and they should not be the passage strains. The number earlier you saw was around 4,800, and it has now reduced to 3,000 odd sequences. Now, again, what we are doing now is a very generic keyword-based search. Okay, so this may not be really clean. Instead, what one should be really doing is download all this data for a more rigorous analysis. If you go to any typical genome entry or any entry in GenBank, you would see records such as what is the isolation source here, what type of strain information, etc. This is what is known as the feature table, which gives you all this information. So generally what we should be doing is clean the data very well beforehand, before you actually carry out any of these multiple sequence alignment or the subsequent phylogeny analysis. Okay, so make sure you know what data you are putting in for the further analysis. Okay, because garbage in is garbage out. Data cleaning is a very, very, very important step before you carry out any of the analysis and try to understand what are the evolutionary relationships, etc. Say, for example, okay, so I'm sure all of you are very aware of what type of different downloads that can be done. There are different ways in which you can download the data. I'm just giving you a simple example.
Excuse me, can you please explain what is meant by passage strain, that function you inserted during the search, that not passage?
Okay. So passaging is when they try to grow the virus in a lab host other than what it is meant to be. For example, typically these are grown in chicken fibroblasts, or they are grown in other cell types, which is not the natural growing host for the virus. Okay, so when they are passaged in the lab, the virus adapts to the environment and therefore it accumulates a lot of mutations. Okay, so when you're doing evolutionary analysis, if your objective is trying to understand, say for example, what is the kind of nucleotide substitution rate, etc., you should be very careful not to include vaccine strains or such passage strains, but just take the only the wild type isolates. Okay, so yeah, I was trying to tell you that we should download the data. So here, for example, I'm just, you can either simply select this, there are n number of ways you can search this databases. Say I've just taken few records, I select them. Okay, I've just randomly chosen few records. You can, as I mentioned, data cleaning is a very important step. You need to know what the objective of your exercise is. Okay, for example, my objective was to align some dengue virus sequences. I can add further identifiers, like I want dengue virus only from India, etc. So the feature table, as I mentioned, is rich with all this metadata information, and you can filter your data based on this. Okay, so I selected few sequences and then I say send to file. Right now I'm interested only in the sequence data, so I say the format is FASTA. Okay, and then I say create file. So using this, I'm able to help my internet.
What happened, Manjari?
Okay, it's not visible. Okay, my screen is not. So I've downloaded a few sequences. I think I need to share. Okay, how do I share all the screens?
You can share your desktop and then can have multiple windows on the desktops. You can switch between windows.
Okay, share screen. Where do I say desktop? Ma'am, here I'm getting option as different windows.
Yeah. So the entire desktop, if you select, then it will help you share your entire desktop. Yeah, desktop. And then you have these files, you know, zoomed in on the desktop, two or three files, and then you can switch between them. That is how I have been using.
Okay. Is this visible now?
Yeah, it is.
Okay. So this is how the downloaded sequences look like. As you all know, FASTA sequence has a greater than symbol followed by a identifier and a small description of what the sequence is, followed by the sequence. These are the single nucleotide codes. Okay. So if I want to check, I've just opened this in a simple editor like context. And it is a very useful, freely available tool. So if you want to see any sequences you can just look for these identifiers. So I had selected five sequences for my download. I just want to check whether all the five are there. So I'm just trying to see how many are there, and it tells me that there are five sequences in this data set. Okay. So I'm ready to go for the next process. That is, I want to carry out a multiple sequence alignment of all these dengue virus genomes that I've downloaded. So for that, we'll be using a tool called MAST. Is this visible?
Yes.
Okay. So as Urmila ma'am explained, multiple sequence alignment uses something called as a progressive alignment approach. How it differs is in a pairwise alignment, you're aligning only two sequences. Here we have more than two. We want to see what is the similarity across all the sequences. So MAFT is a very efficient implementation of progressive as well as a dynamic programming approach. MAFT stands for multiple alignment using fast Fourier transformation. That is what the tool does. Currently, there are earlier tools like Clustal, but MAFT has proved to be more computationally efficient. In fact, and also the developers have been updating as per the needs. For example, they have tried to build a lightweight version for the MSA of SARS-CoV-2 genomes. As we all know, there are more than 15 lakh genomes. So there's a lightweight version they have developed even for that. So this is a very efficient tool for multiple sequence alignment. So we can here use the, I'll just browse the data that I have. I can browse the FASTA sequences file here. Before I submit, it is asking, it has few implementation options. As it mentioned, it uses both progressive as well as a iterative refinement method, which is again based on dynamic programming and is very close, very compute intensive. Okay, the progressive one is very fast and you get it in a very realistic time scales. Apart from that, there is something called scoring matrix. I mean, I'm sure all of you must have used BLAST, etc. So in you have these scoring matrices, which actually allow you to score your alignment based on these matrices have been developed, taking into account the ancestry and on based on hidden Markov model principles, Markov principles. So for example, if, because the data is a nucleotide sequence data, we have something called the PAM series of matrices. Here you have a choice. There is one PAM, 20 PAM, 200 PAM, etc. So they've given a hint that if you want to switch, if you want, you are really aligning very closely related DNA sequences, it is best to switch with PAM one. PAM stands for percent accepted mutations. This is one of the ways in which the nucleotides, whether it's the transitions or the transversions, they are scored accordingly by taking into account both the physiological role as well as the evolutionary context into picture. So right now I just changed only this because we are not doing any amino acid alignment. We leave the other things as it is and then we just submit it. So it is preparing my input file. So this is the at the back end, this because it's a web server, at the back end, the command it has shown, and you can download the output in either the FASTA format or the Clustal format. This is how the output of Clustal looks. You had seen in Urmilaman's presentation, there are something called stars. Stars means exactly identical positions. Okay. A dot is an allowed substitution. Now, A has been substituted by G in this sequence, adenine with guanine. Both are still purine, so it is allowed substitution. Okay, let us see if there are any gaps. Yeah, you can see here, there are gaps inserted. So whenever a gap doesn't mean a break in the DNA or the nucleotide, it is just the alignment, the algorithm has actually inserted this in order to optimize the similarity or the, basically it's optimizing the alignment, okay? So it is, whenever there is a gap introduced, you pay a penalty to it. So from the your overall alignment score, that it gets subtracted. So this is how the Clustal output looks like of the alignment. Let us download the FASTA format of this because it's it goes directly. You can just save the link as. Saving it, you can give a name to it, sample ALN.fasta. FASTA is the file that it is storing. Now this alignment is going to go as an input for the next step, which is actually the file again. So this alignment is going to go as an input for phylogeny. So for phylogeny, we are going to use a web server called IQ Tree. Another thing I want to mention is there are these servers very good for handling data with a certain volume. If you really want to deal with very large data sets, the standalone versions of these tools are available. You can always download MAFT as well as IQTree and run if you have very powerful servers in your infrastructure, in your computing infrastructure. Okay, so IQTree is basically reconstructing phylogeny under the maximum likelihood model. So here, the input for alignment-based phylogenetic reconstruction methods is the multiple sequence alignment. So we provide the alignment here. Okay, I've just used this. And then we can specify whether it is a DNA protein. You can also do a codon alignment. It can also handle binary data, etc. It can also handle partition data. So what is partition data? Suppose you are taking the entire genome. You know a certain portion of the genome has genic data and the other is non-genic data. So you can it can use evolutionary models pertaining to genic data and non-genic data if you are able to partition. So you can say, for example, 1 to 500 is where my gene is and 500 to 700 is a non-genic area. So it let accordingly use the evolutionary model. Okay, so the substitution model, what IQTree does at the back end is it does model selection. Model is the nucleotide substitution model. It does in a when you don't specify beforehand, if you are aware, you have already done model selection beforehand, you can specify those. These are the different models available for DNA. The JC stands for Duke Scanter, HKY, etc. Okay, so for now, we'll just leave it for in auto mode. Then this is the important part of bootstrap analysis. So what ma'am has extensively told in the lecture before. So here we are using a set of only 5 genomes, for example, and the genome length is only 11,000 base pairs. Then Bootstrap does is creates multiple bootstrap alignments. For example, here it is by default 1,000 using what is called an ultra bootstrap method. Okay, so what is really happening in Bootstrap is some of the columns in the alignment are sampled more than once and the others are left out. But overall, the alignment length is kept constant. So using this resampling methodology, you're generating n number of such alignments. And okay, for now, let us not get into these brand selection tests and all. And here you can specify your email ID. If you want, because sometimes the job takes longer time to run, depending on it's a web server used by everyone. Right now the load is 60%, so I may not get the output immediately. Okay, so I submit the job. It says the job was submitted successfully. So it is in running mode. If you look at the log, it is telling me at which stage of the execution it is. The command it has used is it has used this IQTree's executable name, -s is a sample, this is the alignment file that we have given. It is trying to test which model best fits, and the bootstrap we have specified as 1,000. Okay, the likelihood ratio test we can ignore for now. So it is giving me a log of the steps that are being carried out. So as ma'am mentioned, not all sites in the alignment, the overall alignment contains 10,777 columns. Is my screen clear for you to read? So there are 10,777 columns, but not all of them are informative. Some of them are, this column here, this line here mentions that out of it, only 3,220 are parsimoniously informative. That is, there is variation in at least two sequences. Okay. So this is what actually gets into the phylogeny reconstruction method. And 116 are singleton sites. That is, they have these are the alignment columns where the variation is there only in one sample. And 7441 are the constant sites. Okay, out of this. So as you can see, even though the alignment is 10,000 odd, what is actually going for phylogeny is only 3,200. The informative sites alone go for the phylogeny. Okay. So it also does a test for composition, because if you have a lot of repeat regions and etc., then the phylogeny may be just whatever relationship you get from that such data may be a false positive. So it checks for composition of the nucleotide, and all these sequences have passed the composition, as well as if there are too many gaps or if there are a lot of ambiguous bases, then phylogeny may not be very clean. So at the initial step itself, it is doing this. It also has given one information that it tries to remove redundant sequences. That is, what are redundant? They are exactly identical sequences. So here it tells me that this nucleotide, this entry, which is ending with 953, is similar to 732. So during the phylogeny steps, for ML steps, this is ignored but actually added in the later steps. So what this does is it tries to reduce the computation. Okay, so it is telling me what are the exactly identical sequences also. So the so for our they also print the unique sequences in this. So out of the five sequences we have taken, two of them are exactly identical. This is also a lot of information. Okay. And then actual model selection, the nucleotide substitution model, which best fits our data, is done. It gives you what is called the information content, either the Bayesian information content or Akiyaki information content, which on based on which our model is selected. There are 88 models, and the best model fit according to both the information criteria is GTR plus F plus I. GTR stands for general time reversible model. We'll be having a look at it tomorrow when we try to build trees using Bayesian methods. Okay. So after this model, now the nucleotide substitution model that best fit our data, model selection is done. Later, what it is doing is it is trying to, the first step in, even though it's a maximum likelihood tree, what it first, in order to start the tree search, it builds a NJ tree, a bio-NJ implementation, a neighbor joining tree is first built. And this neighbor joining tree is used to select different candidate trees based on parsimony method. So even though the implementation is called maximum likelihood, as you can see, in order to arrive at the best tree, they use n number of filters and methods to actually arrive at the best tree. So if they are computing, they are doing a nearest neighbor search with the three best initial trees. So they start off with three different initial parsimonious trees, and then the actual log likelihood values that are used for maximum likelihood based methods, these are calculated. And these are all the different logs. It's telling me what are the different trait factors, what is the adenosine to cytosine, what are the frequency variations, etc. All that are provided here, and what you end up getting is a you've got a best tree. Let us look how the best tree looks like. So if you go to the full result, we gave you a pictorial representation of this. Okay, so This is a small pictorial representation of this. Okay. This tree, you can also download by selecting this. You can download the entire folder, which will contain all the log files and the best tree, etc. Here you have the tree in NEVIC format. We can use different visualizers for it. The branches with the consensus tree is given. The consensus tree is selected. Consensus is out of the so many thousand bootstrap trees. This is a tree that was found to be best, in which 86 this particular sequence came was always found to be together with this particular sequence 100 times. That is, all the data sets, they were always together with 100% bootstrap support. Okay, whereas others do not have such support. Let us see in a different visualizer. Okay, so I can copy this tree. There's one very nice visualizer called ITAL. It is EMBL one. Again, all these, I can give it tree name. I can give it tree name, and I can just paste it or I can browse it. Okay. I just say upload. ITAL again. Control panel. So this is the tree that we were talking about. You can view it in a circular. Is this clear? Just increase the width of the line. This is a very good.
Just improve the weight of line branches.
Yes. Yeah. So you have different representation. One is circular. The other is rectangular. Okay, other one is unrooted. Okay, so this is just because a sample tree I've taken. You can also color it using different advanced parameters. For example, I want to color based on the bootstrap values. Okay, I want to color using, say, this is the fill color. So it's got
to... wait a minute. I will go to the... No. No. That's what. That is clear. Wait. How do I go there? I will go to the more. No.
Jayaraman sir, your mic is on.
Prash, how do you make you host back again? Yeah.
So this is the bootstrap value. It tells me other branches are lying on the root itself, but here these two sequences come together all the 100 times. Okay. So this is a very nice visualizer called ITAL, which you can use. There are also other visualizers like FigTree, which you can download. These are standalone versions, and the ITAL is a web-based one. So any doubts so far for carrying out multiple sequence alignment as well as phylogeny and visualizing the phylogeny using ITAL?
That was what I told him. But he bothered to feel courteous, to consider this. That is what I really felt.
Ma'am, should I go to RTD?
But this thing could have really dealt in a more professional way. But I think I just leave it to Sundar, the Aparna Subhan Renaka to,
Ma'am?
Yeah.
So should we?
Yeah, we can just move ahead.
Yeah.
So we can proceed.
Yeah.
Hey, Prash, hi. You guys are audible.
Okay, so that was about alignment based approaches for phylogeny reconstruction. So coming to alignment free methods, alignment free methods have been developed by by our group in the Bioinformatics Center, University of Pune. So this is the website. As ma'am was mentioned, there are different databases as well as servers for this, for Aeromonas, Dengue, human rhinovirus. Today we'll be looking at mom's genotyping. So just open that. And today's exercises, I hope. So, as ma'am mentioned, ma'am, you'll be telling.
So, as I was describing, you know, this MUMS virus genotyping tool uses multiple methods, and users have option to use all of them or any one of them. So, you know, here these methods have been listed. So, by the way, there are these tabs like home, class search, phylogeny, RTD-based genotyping, combined analysis. We have kept our sample data sets online and also validation results, etc. So we can just usually go to the combined analysis based on genotyping. So this combined analysis tab allows you to use all the methods. So you can just load the sample sequences, Manjari. If you click on sample sequences, it will load those sequences. Else, you, the way Manjari showed you, you can get on to, you know, nucleotide or any other databases and curate your own data for typing purpose. So when you load the sample sequences, at the moment, I think there are three sequences as a query sequence. And we say, we just give, click the submit button. Once you click the submit button, the server would collect the input data, and then this input data will be taken up by all the three methods, and the genotype would be assigned. So here,
excuse me, ma'am, from where we will be collecting those sample sequences?
So right now, all our servers provide you with some sample data, demo data, but otherwise, you can go to nucleotide, GenBank nucleotide database, perform the queries, and can collect your own data that you would like to analyze. Another source of data collection is experiments. If you have characterized SH gene sequences from the patients, then you can have them stored in the FASTA format and can provide them as an input to this particular server. Okay,
ma'am.
Yeah. So the first here, since we are using demo sequences, these have been extracted from the GenBank. So this is the GenBank ID. Then it is predicted to belong to the genotype. The percent identity is given here, and the query start and end position. So SH gene, small hydrophobic gene, as I mentioned to you, has been used and is recommended by ICTV for typing. So it is a small region. That is why you could see that server runs really fast. And then this typing is done. Then for the other two sequence, respective genotypes are H and F, okay? Then this is genotyping using RTD method. So the first was the BLAST-based output, second is RTD, and third is by phylogeny. And we retain your results for 15 days on the server, but after 15 days, those files are deleted. So for genotyping using RTD, the types would be assigned and they will be predicted. But for phylogeny, we provide you an option to download alignment file or the NJDND file. So maybe Manjari can show that file.
Yeah.
that NJDND file is can be imported in the visualizer, like FigTree or IQ tree and then you can visualize them. So, and it is the same procedure for visualization. So this particular server, you're showing them?
Yeah, okay. Just to show the reference sequences.
Right, correct. So although we provided or we wanted to type just three sequences, the server at the back end used several sequences as a reference data set. And the three sequences along with the reference data set are clustered using all the three methods. And in the end, what you get is this kind of tree. So we can have a circular tree.
Yes.
Yeah. If you just zoom it out a bit. So the way, you know, nomenclature has been tip labels, the OTU labels, the first character invariably is the genotype. So you have A to M genotypes for mumps viruses. Of course, you know, when we developed the server, there was only one entry for K genotype, but now there are additional entries and we will be uploading the new reference data set as well. So as a result of that, you just see one entry with K genotype, but and this is a circular tree. What it shows, if you can zoom it out.
Yeah.
Or in maybe.
Yeah.
Okay. So you can now, your database IDs where we'll have to find out that, Manjari.
Yeah.
DEU and HHQ, right? So you can do Control F DEU. DEU, right?
Yeah.
So you can just select that and visualize where it is. Yeah. And it is here. And if you look at, you know, it clusters in proximity with other isolates of D type. And that is how D genotype is assigned to this particular entry. Since these are demo sequences, we have also labeled the known genotype from the GenBank annotation. But you may have a sequence for which a genotype is not known. You can just provide it as an input and the server would give you in return the genotype for this. It is pretty simple to use. We have help files and documentation. We also have given our complete reference data set, test data sets to you on the server. So you can please feel free to explore. The validation also gives you, you know, inputs with respect to, so this is the composition of our reference data set. It includes these entries for which, you know, genotypes are known. Okay. Then the test data set is provided, which are known genotypes. We wanted to benchmark the performance. And then you, what is very important in developing any knowledge-based server is, you know, inclusion of true positives and true negatives. So in order to test the sensitivity and specificity, we had identified, you know, related paramyxoviruses, SH gene of related paramyxoviruses as negative data set. Because, you know, if you take any other paramyxovirus and SH gene, you know, it should be able to say that genotype cannot be assigned to this. This is not the mumps SH sequence. So we have provided all those data set, including the true negative. The fourth line from the top, you know, refers to our true negative data set. And the GenBank IDs are provided, like, you know, rubella virus and others are provided. So this is how we have developed this server. Maybe Manjari, we can go to the, this is on the basis of single gene, SH gene. But if we go to, you know, dengue typer,
dengue subtype. Okay, so again the interfaces are pretty similar. You can just load the sample input, or you can have any other, you know, data, whatever maybe Manjari you have curated. You
can provide exercises.
From the exercises they can do. You submit, you can either paste the sequences or upload the file containing the sequences. The server would take some time and will give you serotype as well as genotype. So as I mentioned, we have four major serotype, dengue 1, 2, 3, 4. And each serotype has respective 4 to 6 genotypes. So that those assignments can be done. And it uses return time distribution approach for assignment of these genotypes. All these servers, you know, they have they are published, and corresponding research papers are also available, in addition to, you know, some other references, related references. So feel free to explore these servers on your own. So here maybe you can just paste the, one of the sequence that you know you those are the complete genomes, right? So dengue subtype requires complete genome sequence as an input. So you can either take all, or you can take just one, whatever is convenient. You just submit, and then, so just like, you know, you perform wet lab experiment and standardize the experiment, bioinformatics servers and the algorithms can be standardized using known data. And you can take one of the entry with the known genome and serotype, give it as an input and see and validate if the server works perfectly fine. Okay, that's the standard way of testing, benchmarking it is called, for the server. So these are pretty intuitive, very simple to navigate.
What will be the difference between the genotype and serotype?
Okay, dengue serotypes, there are four, the dengue 1, 2, 3, 4, they are pretty similar to four different viruses. Okay, they are serologically very distinct. And that is why the serotype, but every serotype, you know, the way viruses have been spreading all over the world and getting adapted. So they diversify into some kind of genotypes. Okay, these are highly similar genotypes or lineages which have similar profile of mutations with them, and that profile of mutation, so let us say dengue virus 1 genotype 1A, the profile will be different from dengue virus 1 genotype 2A, let us say, for example. So they have these characteristic nucleotides at very specific positions which confer them with the phenotypic properties for these lineages, and that is why you have different serotypes and different genotypes. So this is a knowledge base that comes from virology. So if you read any of the article, review article pertaining to, you know, dengue viruses, you will be able to find out what kind of genotypes and serotypes are circulating currently in the world. So viruses adopt, you may have silvatic in dengue 3, let us say, so which grows exclusively in animals in the silvatic habitat of Malaysia. But then, you know, they jumped the host, and then you have human and animal infections, and then they further diversify into different genotypes. So this is a very interesting hierarchy with respect to viral taxonomy, that you have a viral species, and then that's gets either subdivided into serotype or genotype. And amongst the genotype, you might also observe certain lineages. And we'll be talking about these details tomorrow when we take population level view of evolution of viruses. So that's the link between today's and tomorrow's plan for discussion.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. So these are our servers. Anything, so Manjari, now what needs to be shown is genome detective.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So Genome Detective is yet another server developed in South Africa. Okay, they also have series of typers, you know, for various viruses, as I have shown you some 15-20 viruses you can type. They also have a typer for SARS-CoV-2. But as I have mentioned, their free public domain version has limited utility. You need to purchase if you want to use all utilities or want to process data in bulk. The difference between our servers and Genome Detective is that Genome Detective takes FASTA sequences as well as raw data from the NGS for the purpose of typing. That's the major difference. So maybe we can show them Dengue tool, which you have linked in the hands-on sessions. So, we have put together some hands-on exercises for you to practice after this demo. Feel free to sort of explore them. And then we can come back for consolidation, right? And we will be around back while you do these exercises.
Yeah. So I hope you all have seen this in the shared Google Drive. Where we have exercises, hands-on exercises for today. One is some sample SH gene sequences using RTD-based classification. And same thing, the whole genome sequences of dengue viruses for understanding the subtype. After that, we have a few rubella genome sequences, rubella virus genome sequences, for which you need to carry out multiple sequence alignment using MAP. And you have to save the outputs in different formats. And using the Clustal, you can calculate how many of the bases are conserved in the alignment. So you can look for those asterisks and dots and colons as compared to the total length, how much that will give you an idea of how much of the genome is conserved. And once the genome alignment is done, you can use it as an input for building the phylogenetic tree using IQ-Tree server. So for that, you use the default parameters of 100 bootstrap replicates. And once you get the output, look at the log file and other data and find out what is the best nucleotide substitution model and visualize the tree and see which nodes have support greater than 70%. Okay. Have you all got access to this particular file on the shared drive that Prash has provided? This drive you all have access to?
Yeah, dear friends, so please ensure that now all these particular files are downloaded. I think I provided in the chat box as well.
Yeah. So you can download these. This is the exercise. The PDF is where the exercises are given. And this is where the sequence data is provided. Download this zip file and unzip. And today's version, you need not install anything. You are just using all the online web-based servers. So please let us know if you can, if you're facing any difficulties.
Hello. Hello.
Yeah.
Ma'am, I have a question. In case of iTOL, we are just pasting the i3 file.
Correct.
In case of uploading, which type of file can be uploaded? Is it
the tree file? You. No. iTOL is a visualizer. Yeah. iTOL is a visualizer of your phylogenetic tree. It is just a visualizer. Okay, so the tree file you can upload. You get, once you download the this IQ tree results, then you have a tree file, you have a dot tree file that which you can upload on iTOL.
Can you please once more show us the genome detective functionality?
Yeah, 1 minute. Mm-hmm. Okay. So genome detective, the link is provided in the file today. So there you just go to the website and say, go to the services here. Okay. Services tab, then online version of genome detective typing tool. Okay.
Manjari, we have provided direct link to dengue genome detective.
Okay. Dengue.
They can directly go there. Yeah. And then later on, they are free to explore their own other typing tools.
Yes. So basically, whatever view you go to, you have these options. You can give the FASTQ data, or you can give the consensus sequences. Right now, we are giving the FASTA sequences. Select the file, and then just drop the, or you can drag and drop the output also. So as ma'am mentioned, genome detective is a alignment-based typer, okay? So you say this and say start free analysis. We have recently become commercial, so the free analysis is little limited. So this is how the output looks like. So it is telling me the data, 5 sequences we have given, out of it, dengue virus 1 is 3 of them belong to dengue virus 1, and this is based upon BLAST assignment. Okay, they are talking about the, they also do a, at the back end, they also do alignment. So they must be having some reference data against which they are talking about how much percentage is variable. So this is what, so if you have an individual report also for each of this. So it's further giving you what is a, basically it is parsing the, it is giving a reference genome. Okay, RefSeq is a reference curated genome at the GenBank. It's this must be their reference data set. It gives you alignment score. You can download the alignment in different formats. It also is giving alignments of different coding regions. As you know, we have given genome. So genome is made up of n number of genes. So it is also giving you the translated amino acids, because its codes are what is called a polyprotein.
This dengue virus is this peculiar feature wherein, yes. Wherein you know one single polyprotein is encoded as a product, and then that polyprotein is digested using the proteases and different proteins, like 3 structural proteins and 7 non-structural proteins are sort of assembled into a virion particle in which the positive stranded DNA is packed. So that is why this alignment provides you with different regions with respect to individual boundaries. And this boundary information comes from the RefSeq entry. And RefSeq entries, a simple way to identify them is they always have this NC code reference entries, GenBank reference section.
They've also linked to that.
Yeah, they have also linked the reference. So this is simple BLAST-based assignment where, you know, at the back end, the best reference hit is used to assign the type to the dengue virus isolate. NCBI also have typers. We will not go into NCBI typers, but they also have some limited typing utilities available for select viruses, and there also BLAST works at the back end. None of these tools, they use rigorous phylogeny based approach to the best of our knowledge so far. And then there are other alignment-free algorithms available for clustering and phylogeny, but they do not have any dedicated typing servers. These are basically the alignment-free algorithms available for clustering your data. And that is why we have not covered other algorithms for alignment-free phylogeny.
Excuse me, ma'am. Does dengue subtyper is only used for dengue viruses or like any other viruses, like even HPV or any other viruses we can use for other subtype for genotyping?
No. So dengue virus subtyper is dedicated and is exclusive for typing of dengue viruses. If you wish to subtype HPVs, then you know a different is required. And if typer is not available, you can use classical phylogeny based approach for assignment of you know types. But HPV typer is under development in the department, and we will soon be making it available. So if you are interested, we can share you know a pre or a raw version with you.
Please write to us. Thank you.
Excuse me,
ma'am. Hello. Yes. In IQ3 web server, there was partition files. So when we use that, can you explain it again? Hello.
Manjari, can we go to IQ3?
Yeah, I'll just share.
Yeah, Sunita and ma'am.
I'll be
away, you know, for next 10 minutes. I hope you'll continue this until 7:45. How is it? Yeah, sorry.
Yes.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much. I'll be back by 7:40. Huh? Thank you so much.
Sure, no problem. Take your time.
So this is how the partition, if they've given a sample example. So if you know what are the different coding regions and non-coding regions in your, for example, if you're taking the entire genome, you know the boundaries, so you can specify what the boundaries are. So here they've specified that part one is 1 to 100, part two is 101 to 200. So the treatment for these two partitions will be different. The substitution models that are selected will be different. Okay, so instead of treating the entire data as a single, trying to fit a single nucleotide substitution model based on different partitions, it will fit. So it is more trying to simulate the realistic scenario. So when you say genome in case viruses and what the data examples we are showing, there are not many, apart from the 3' and 5' UTRs, there are not many non-coding elements, but you have other viruses where you have single UTR regions and multiple UTRs. So there we can give this kind of partition file, if you know the boundaries.
Oh, okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah, so partition files are the gene boundary annotations. You know, you can resort to GenBank entries. But for models for fitting the analysis, actually, you know, see both sequence alignments and phylogenetic analysis, they are, you know, huge components themselves. So this is just an initiation or a primer. Feel free to explore these tools, because all these tools come with wonderful documentation and available, you know, reading material. So you can use that and then sort of self-train with respect to some of the aspects that, you know, we couldn't cover due to paucity of time. But these are, you would require at least like 1 credit course means 15 hours at least for phylogeny and 15 hours for alignments, which we tried to compile in 3 hours.
So as ma'am mentioned, they are wonderful start tutorials. You can refer to them where they have worked out each and every step.
Ma'am, I just tried the first hands-on exercise and the output did not appear. It says that the file must be it says software error, no such file or directory at combined1.cg1.
Which exercise is that?
This is with the MAMS virus, SH gene sequences.
Can we rerun that, Manjari?
Okay. Yeah.
I uploaded the sequence that was in the zip file.
Zipped file?
Yeah.
No, sorry. Oh, sorry. You have to unzip it. Yeah.
Okay. Right.
So you go to that link. 1 minute. Huh?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I did unzip it. I did.
You unzipped it and you gave the MUV file itself. I'll download it. And
master file you need to provide as an
input. Yeah. It was the shgene.faster file.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the one that I uploaded.
Okay, let me just try. So you chose this genotyping by BLAST, phylogeny, and RTD?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. There is SH, right?
Yeah.
SH gene. The No, SH.
Yes.
Open. Thank you. What happened? So some error it is giving, which maybe Manjari, we may have to look into this. This we may have to look into. I don't know why.
Thank you.
So if you can see, I think this is something that we need to fix. It is trying to go to different computers on our server to fetch files, and there could be some error with respect to that. Maybe we can try the exercise with respect to dengue viruses and see if because this porting it onto the cloud, maybe. So with demo datasets, we tested yesterday, it was working. But with new data set, we should have tested.
I tried with this also. It was working.
It was, no?
Yes, ma'am. I tried the second one and it worked. I'm not sure of the third one. I didn't try it yet.
Dengue is working.
Dengue is working.
Right.
Yes. But
we did test with the new SH data set yesterday, right?
Yes, ma'am.
RTD based, just go to the RTD based and see if it works.
Yes,
SH. Oh, okay. So this we need to look into. We'll just.
So by tomorrow, maybe we can
fix it. Yes.
Yeah. So you can go to the dengue subtyping that is working. And you can do genome detective, MAFT, and IQ tree. MUV typing, you can do it. Yeah, tomorrow we'll fix it by then.
Always there will be Murphy's law works always. Whenever you want to show demo, there will be some component count. All other days it works fine. So it is dengue. For the first entry, it was dengue 1, serotype 1, and genotype 3, I guess.
Yes, ma'am.
That piped some cryptic annotation Pandoram provides.
Yes.
Anjali, I will be back in a couple of minutes.
Yes. In the drive, the shared drive, no, I've just put in one sequence now, sh_gene_ind.fasta. Can you use that instead of the sequence I've given for typing using MUV genotyping server?
So you tested it before giving?
Yes, ma'am. It's tested it.
Okay.
Say genotyping by RTD. You choose that RTD based genotyping. Himasha, you had issue with that, right? So did you find the file? The name of the file?
Actually, ma'am, Esther had the issue. I am downloading the file.
Okay. I'll just put the name in the shared drive. All of you can use this sh_gene_ind.fasta. It's there in the root itself where the tutorial is there.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Yeah.
So you can run only the RTD based phylogeny for now.
Yeah. Yes.
So that you get the typing done using RTD. Looks like we will have to look at the other two methods.
Yes. Excuse me, ma'am, but using that sh_gene_ind, I am facing some problem and it's giving some sort of error.
Manjiri, you share the screen and show
I'll
the
share, yeah.
Probably
yeah.
They are using you know, all methods combined window.
Yeah, I'll just
instead open. They need to use specific window for RTD.
Yeah.
So all of you can have a look at this. For some
this MUV genotyping server. I chose that. If you're finding issue with browsing, just try copy pasting the sequence in the window. I'm opening this file. Yeah, just select all the sequences. And then instead of browsing, just put the data in the window and say submit. I think the browsing browse button has some issues, ma'am.
Okay.
Because if I copy paste it, I'm able to get the genotype. If you paste it in the box, the path seems to be some issue.
Can you show your screen for the MUV typer and paste it and run it?
Yeah.
One. So
is
that
this clear? Am I? Is my screen visible?
Yes.
Okay. Just a minute. I'm going back. I'll clear. So I've selected all the sequences. Okay. SHI.
Excuse me. I am seeing your drive screen.
Achcha. Sorry. I'll stop and share proper one.
Share your entire desktop, Manjuri, so that as you switch.
That option I'm not getting. Okay. I'm not getting. I'm getting different windows.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Is this visible now?
Yes.
Okay. So in this, I've just selected all the sequences. Okay. And then I say Control A, Control C, and Control V. I pasted in this, and then I say submit. Okay. So that browsing seems to have an issue. Just open your the sequences in either TextPad or Notepad or any text editor. Select it and then paste it in the box.
And the option that you need to explore is RTD based.
RTD based data typing,
not the combined one.
Yeah.
Okay, now it is working because I was accessing through that choose file button and giving some error.
Okay.
Yes.
We will fix it back tomorrow.
Yeah. Tomorrow we'll fix it. Yeah.
Ma'am, can I ask another question?
Sure.
In the MAFT server, how do you check the percentage of conserved bases?
Yeah. So you download this in Clustal format. Okay. You download this output in Clustal format and look at the check out the length of the alignment. Okay. This is a little exercise that you have to do. It's not ready made. Check out the length of the alignment. Find out how many are this asterisk means they're completely conserved, right? Okay. Yeah. Check out how many conserved, even the dot is a allowed substitution. Okay. Check out how many of such positions are there and divide it by the total length of the alignment. You will get the similarity. And if you want only identity, look out only for the number of asterisks.
I thought there was a place to find the percentage.
There are places, but bioinformatics is not just running servers, right? You have to analyze, write some scripts, or maybe even do a simple Excel kind of stuff also.
Yeah, okay.
But so to give you a flavor of it, it's not just running one server after the other. You need, if you want to get more information, you need to process.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, another way is there's a tool called Mega.
Clustal Mega, they would pre-compute percent identity, percent similarity, and give you along with some alignment score. And then for pairwise,
those are the ready-made tools.
Right. And for pairwise alignment that I discussed, we have needle and water. Programs available at Emboss. EBI website, EBI Emboss tool. Maybe we did not include them explicitly in the hands-on or demo, but Manjuri, you can show them a quick demo of pairwise alignment, where the concept of identity similarity will get clarified.
Is this visible?
Yes, it is visible. Just one small question. If I count from that cluster format that all the asterisks one, that will be giving the sequence identity.
Correct. Yes.
And if I include that single dot also, then it will be giving sequence similarity.
As well as colon. Single dot as well as colon.
As well as colon. Okay.
Then it will give you similarity.
Okay.
Ma'am, in mass representation for nucleotide, they are not giving colon. They're giving dot only. Dot and
purine, purine, pyrimidine, pyrimidine, and purine, pyrimidine.
Yeah, for protein, they give that colon.
So since only four bases are there for nucleotide comparison, you know,
yes,
you have only a purine, purine substitution as similar and pyrimidine, pyrimidine as similar. But for 20 amino acids, you know, there are preferred substitutions. And as Manjari mentioned, you can use scoring matrices to further identify levels of similarity based on the properties that are used to derive the matrices. Then that concept of similarity comes in. It is more evident for protein sequences than for nucleotide sequences. So this is a quick demo for pairwise alignment, global alignment, Needleman and Wunsch algorithm. So Needle program is there. And for local alignment, Smith-Waterman algorithm. So the name of the program is water.
This is the local alignment. And here, protein sequences, I've just taken whatever is given as example. This is the hemoglobin alpha subunit of human. And because it is pairwise, we have two sequences. And the other is from mouse. So these are orthologs, as ma'am explained. So it is the same hemoglobin alpha from two different species. Okay. And say,
what is the name of the program, Manjari, here? Which one you have selected?
Water, ma'am.
Water, okay. Local.
Yes, local. And it is protein-based alignment.
Yeah.
So when you say submit.
So local alignment or water program is typically used to identify small regions of similarity. But if two sequences are orthologous or if they share significant similarity from end to end, then that local alignment region will be as big as the global alignment. Okay. So here, even if you are using local alignment, it is showing you end-to-end global alignment for a simple fact that region of similarity expands end-to-end. Here it will show you identity, 122 identities out of 142 length, so 85.9% identity. You will always have similarity greater than or equal to identity in case of protein sequences, never less. And you have gaps, zero gaps in this. So identity and similarity you denote or convey by percentage or by absolute numbers. But when you are discussing homology, please never use the term percent homology. Homology is a qualitative description of relationship. It has a binary answer that two sequences are either homologous or they are not homologous. There is nothing like 50% homology, 60% homology. That's a wrong usage of terms. Please keep this in mind.
And in cholesterol output, they use an asterisk symbol for conserved. Here they're using a dash.
Yeah, pipe.
Pipe
for identities. So all this, you know, customization or variation with respect to individual outputs, just refer to the, manuals for these algorithms. So they will typically give you sample input, sample output, how to interpret, what kind of queries you may have, frequently asked questions. So for bioinformatics, frankly speaking, you know, you just have to develop interest and you don't need teachers.
So that was the local alignment, which was just, but it happened to be an example where it matched end to end. So Needle is
for global.
For global. just use the same thing. Okay, this, they use the same example. I think the values will slightly differ.
Yeah.
They use the same hemoglobin sequence from human and the mouse.
Maybe you can try SH gene from one genotype to other, something like that. They can try later on.
Yes.
Or they can try aligning alpha chain of hemoglobin of human with beta chain of hemoglobin of human. Some exercises they need to. Or you all must be working in your respective domains. So try to extract data from your live projects and try to use or analyze using these tools. And that will give you real perspective because you would be familiar with the domain knowledge. Because working in plants can analyze plant data as well.
You already brought wonderful life to this workshop. Thank you.
Thank you. So, I mean, how are we doing with respect to assignments?
So I hope you all agree with me that assignments are not just, you know, from NGS or Jayaraman's side. It's also from Urmila ma'am and Sunita's side as well. So they're also not going to leave you. So please do that. Yeah.
No, I mean, if they are now comfortable, they can solve these assignments in their free time tomorrow morning or something like that. Because I just read your message that you would like to have them continued in the session for some NGS or some other assignments. Yes,
for 15 minutes, ma'am. I mean, maybe we have, you can take another 7 minutes or you can suggest them. I can take from 8 to 8:15. I just want to, otherwise I can take one small demo for 15 minutes and then probably you can continue.
No problem. So only point I was trying to convey that we are done with our demos.
Yes.
And most of them have done their at least two assignments. Everybody is through, right? Two or three. There are total four assignments, Manjari.
Yes, ma'am. And one thing is that we need the phylogenetic tree of rubella for tomorrow's beast tutorial. So please submit the job. You may get the output tomorrow, but make sure you have the
But just in case, you know, somebody is not able to, you can always provide your own tree.
Yeah.
Share drive,
Yeah.
I mean, let that not be the limiting factor for tomorrow's assignment.
Yeah. And one more thing, tomorrow's assignment, we need beast package to be installed on your laptops. So for beast requires Java. I hope all of you can do that. I've given the links in the exercise today. And the same thing, day two has the links for the beast download. Yeah. So please download that and keep. Otherwise, time will unnecessary. We'll spend tomorrow in just installing. There's nothing to be installed. You just need to download and extract. These are jar files. You just need Java on your machine. Ma'am, they have couple of them have finished exercises.
Finished, yes.
Yeah.
Ma'am, whether this constructing this phylogenetic tree using this rubella virus will take some time because
Okay. There's some load on the server, so it may take some time. That's why just give your email ID. So once you're done with it, you'll get you can download the file.
Okay, okay.
But just in case some of you are not able to get the results, we will still provide you with the file tomorrow.
Yeah, tomorrow, yes.
But it is in your interest. We encourage you to do it yourself so that, you know, you will be able to work independently later on. So I guess, okay, there are 3-4 more minutes.
So friends, please, participants, please feel free to ask questions. Madam and Sunita are, however, there in the chat as well, in the WhatsApp group. And they're also there tomorrow and also after that as well, if you have any questions.
Right. So bye for now.
Yeah, I think we should give a big round of applause, and thank ma'am and Sunita again. Thank you so much, ma'am and Sunita, for the wonderful speech. So, yeah, so I'll share the recording, all of you. I hope it's okay if we upload this to the YouTube page later, ma'am. Is that fine, Sunita and
absolutely,
ma'am?
Absolutely fine. Please feel free to upload.
Thank you, ma'am. So friends, I think yesterday, you know, since every day, you know, we are going through this, we were discussing about the difference between Bhavati and ISAT 2. So ISAT 2 runs on the premise that the splice alignments are catered into it, whereas, you know, Bhavati 2 doesn't, you know, take the spliced alignments. So this is what, you know, we obtained for AG38. There are about, you know, 8 files. So 1, 2 with these files, you know, are like this. Okay, this one and this one all together, you know, makes about, you know, 2 GB, you know, so it's for a haploid data set, just like, you know, Bhavati 2, how we got 6 files, 4 for forward and 2 for reverse files. So yesterday, I was running, you know, this file, if you remember, before we ended up. Okay, so we ran Bhavati 2 minus 6. We also didn't run ISAT because ISAT was still running. So now that it is finished, we can also run, you know, ISAT 2 in a similar way. So this is what we have done. So Bhavati 2 minus X, AG38 as a reference, minus 1 Z14_1.fq, minus 2 Z14_2.fq, the forward and the reverse, and minus S is SAM file. Okay. And this is what I gave, and it has been running. Okay. It's, the server is a bit slow, but as good. So 457 MB has been generated. Okay. And now, since it is running, since you could see, once I give LS minus LRTH, the time is 8 p.m. here, 2000 hours. So Z14.sms SAM is still running. Okay. So if you really want to see how the SAM file looks, so this is how it looks. Okay. This is how it does. And then the SAM needs to be converted to BAM file. Okay. So just to see the contents of this particular file that we are running. So this is what, you know, we are running the steps. So since we are running a whole exome sequencing and whole genome sequencing. So FastQC was the first step we have done. Then we ran this Bhavati 2. Okay. And then you can simply copy this SAM tools, import this file, and then you can convert your, what you call SAM to BAM like this. So I've simply right click, copied and pasted it here. So SAM tools input, but the good thing is here you have to give enter hg38.fa file, okay? And then z14.sam space z14.bam, okay? And then you can run ampersand z14.bam is your output file, okay? You can also give like this as well, okay? Even if you give space, that doesn't matter, Okay, so SAM is converted to BAM. That's because BAM is a binary alignment mapping. Can someone tell me why do we need to convert SAM to BAM, please? Yeah. I think I told you. Yeah, please. Can someone tell me why do we need to run SAM to BAM? Yeah. Yes, please. Yeah. Can someone tell me? Hello. I hope I'm not alone. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So binary file can be read. No, it's not that. Yeah. You know, both are read. I can also view the BAM file now or SAM file now. I just showed. Right.
Excuse me. I think if we convert it into binary file, then will the computer will be able to read it or more faster? That so that's why we are converting it to binary.
Not only faster, but the most important thing is, what is that? We can save the space, isn't it? Okay, you know, SAM is in a huge file. It will be in gigs again. It will be 3 times the size of your FASTQ file. But when you run BAM, okay, you know, that SAM file, which is, you know, 3 times the size of FASTQ, will be reduced to almost, you know, 3 times the normal. So it will be automatically again equivalent to the normal FASTQ file. So binary is nothing but ones and zeros. So your file will be drastically reduced. So that is what, you know, the BAM file is. As you could see here, with the initial runs, you know, it's only 9 MB now. So of course it's still running, okay, 13 MB and all, but the size will be almost, you know, reduced to half of its size. But if you type ahead z14.bam, okay, sorry, I need to give this head z14.bam. As you could see, it's a binary file. You cannot read the binary file. It's in a machine learning file or a format or a binary alignment mapping. Okay, but let it run. You know, it will take some time. Okay, is it clear? And now, so you need to do it, you know, from your command. Okay, so please be very careful. And like the next step, when I run cat is view or concatenate xpipe_14.sh. Okay. So you can convert your BAM to sorted BAM. Why do we need to convert to sorted BAM? Can anyone tell me? I told you this thing as well. Why do we need to run a BAM file to a sorted BAM? Yes. Because in a normal BAM file, the chromosomal positions are not in alphabetical order, which means, you know, as I showed you in this file, okay, sorry, z14.sam, you see, here when I type that head, view the contents of the topmost file, it's an unsorted, you see, the very first one is chromosome 1, then came chromosome 10, the line number is this much, it is not line number 1, okay, so it is absolutely, you know, the sequence number is chromosome 10, this thing. So it's not in alphabetical order. So it should start with chromosome 1, chromosome 2, chromosome 3, and so on and so forth. Okay. So that is one of the reasons why you need to convert that BAM into a sorted BAM. So in order to run your sorted BAM, okay, since BAM is running, I can also give this particular command, but it will be a truncated file. It's not a full file because SAM is still running. Okay. So I need to give this and again give ampersand. Okay. So SAM tool sort z14.bam /, greater than symbol, z14.sorted.bam is your output file. Okay. So you can also give like this as well, space minus O. Okay. Or like this. Okay. But it says that, you know, the input is probably truncated. It is not really allowing me to do that. Okay. Because it's still running. So don't worry, let it run, but you have to do it, you know, whenever you are there, you know, running on your server. You see, Z14 BAM, it's still running 8:05. The time is 8:05 here on my time, on my clock. So it's still running. Okay. So unless it is done, you know, it will not run. Since these are huge files, you have to wait. You need to have patience. That is the reason, you know, why please keep your computer on, keep the server on. And if you're sleeping in the night, run the command and see every 3 hours, or maybe you can check it in the morning. Okay. Is it clear? So likewise, the next command is, once you run this sorted BAM, sometimes, you know, you need to index. Index is nothing but, you know, what is an index in a in a book. Can someone tell me what is an index?
It points to something important or the location of something.
Exactly. So, you know, if sometimes you may have to find for a sequence this position, for line number, you need to go to and toggle to that particular page. So likewise, you can also give this particular command, okay, like this. Okay, so it will not allow me to run because it says end of the file marker is absent because the file is still running. Okay, the input is properly truncated karke bol raha hai, matlab it is still, you know, running. Okay, so please don't run this. Only run once your SAM is done, once your BAM is done, and then go ahead. I'm just trying to tell you because you have a long weekend tomorrow, Saturday and Sunday. I'll not be there for your hands-on, but I'll be there in the chat box. Okay, but I'll not be giving you this demo. So this whole genome sequencing or whole exome sequencing until BCF file, you need to do it until at least Monday. So you have at least 3 nights and 4 days. Okay, so you can, you know, try to work, you know, towards this. Okay, and then you need to have your index files. Once you run index, okay, you are giving an output BAI. BAI is BAM index file. Okay, and next comes merge file. Sometimes when you give an index file, it will create, you know, several indexes. Okay, 1, 2, 3 and all. So you can merge all your, you know, merged files with you know, whatever sorted files that you are doing. Sorted 1, sorted 2, sorted 3 to an output called merge.bam. In fact, this is your output file here and this is your input file. So z14.sorted.star. Star means all. Okay. So z14.sorted.1, z14.sorted.2.bam, z14.sorted.3.bam, all files which are there, they will be merged to this particular file called z14.merge.bam. This is only for you. Okay, but this is an optional command. You need not do it. This you can do it only when your file size is big. So don't worry. Okay. Can you see me? Can you see my video? All of you?
Yes.
Can you see me here? Yeah.
Yes, we can see.
Okay. So good. So what happens is the most important command, the next that you need to do is something called mpylab. MPylab is, you know, what happens is when you develop this BAM file, so all these files, you know, are stacked like this, you know, like this, you know, like this, you know, small papers. So you need to pile them up. You need to, you know, bring them up, you know, like this. Okay. You need to pile them up like this. So this is called MPylab. MPylab is M is multiple pylab. So SAM tools MPylab is a command. So all the sorted files should be MPiled up. Okay. And the file output is z14.mpile.bam. Okay. So when you do this, all your BAM files that are there, 1, 2, 3, 4 will be piled up, you know, in a stack. Okay. And then you can give another command called mpile up to snips. So whatever snips you want to call, you can use a command called varscan. Varscan is a program. There are three important variant calling pipelines or snip calling pipelines. One is varscan. Okay. The other one is VT and the third one is ANOVA. Okay, so you can use any of those three commands, but we are using, you know, varscan here. So you can use varscan mpylab to snip. So you're calling snips from your mpylab file and you need to give z14.mpylab.bam, which you have generated here, and the output is z14.mpylab.snips. Likewise, indels. You know the difference between snips and indels, dear participants? Yeah, you know the difference between a snip and an indel. Indel is an insertion deletion. It's also a snip. It's also a mutation. Whereas a single nucleotide polymorphism will precisely tell you what exactly the mutation is. If there is an A at that position, is it altered with T? If there is a T, that is altered with G. But in an insertion or deletion, not necessarily you'll have, you know, what you call, you know, a position in the replaced base. So if A is replaced with dot, or maybe A is replaced with something else. Okay, maybe in your reference you might be having no base, but in your alternative allele you might be having a specific base. Okay, so that is what we call it as, you know, insertion and deletion. So you're also calling indels here. Okay, and then you can also use filter option and use your snips output file and generate your snips.filter. You can filter. You know, filter is nothing but a snip file will be pretty huge with all the statistics. You can reduce it to snips.filter. Okay. And then you can use a command called read counts. Okay, then you can use z14.mpylab.bam and then use read counts. Okay, and the most important thing is the final step, almost the two steps. There are two important files. The final output for any calling the variants is something called variant calling format file. That can also be something called binary calling variant format. Okay, so a VCF file usually constitutes the chromosomal position, chromosomal number, the position, the reference allele, the alternative allele, and what is that particular SNP's minor allele frequency. Okay, what is the minor allele frequency for a normal statistics? Can you tell me? I told you during the presentation. It is 0.05, which means 5%. So if there is any change in the mutations that you really want to observe within the population, that minor allele frequency is with a change of 5%. So if you really want to see mutations that are altered between you and me, then you can say that the cutoff can be minor allele frequency of 5%, which is 0.05, just like probability of 0.05. Okay, for a rare disease, it is 1%. It is 0.01%. Okay, I'll tell you, you know, how to do the downstream annotation for that. So please don't worry about that. Okay, so for that, you need to run something called SAMTools mpylab. -2f is the entire file that you really want to run. What is that reference file? That is hg38.fa. Okay, with the same file you have also given here in SAMTools import option. Okay, this you need to give. Okay, and then z14.sorted.bam, the final sorted.bam, and pipe symbol. VCF tools is a command to call the variants, the binary calling variant format tools. It is called VCF. View, what is that you need to view? Your z14.sorted.bam and the output is z14.raw.vcf. Okay, and in a similar way, you can use CAMD option to get the back.file. Back is a binary quality mapping file. Okay, it's only an optional one, so please don't worry, don't stress out if you really don't want to run this particular command. Okay, this is only to view certain commands, so you need not run this. And finally, the raw.vcf file that is generated, you need to convert to a VCF file. That you can view it using VCF tools, view, z14.raw.vcf is the file that you have generated here, and output is z14.vcf. So this is your final command. Okay, so this command, all these commands are common for either whole genome sequencing or whole exome sequencing. Okay, so this you need to do it by running in your respective folders. Go to your respective folders. If you are want to call that particular file in the previous file, simply give dot dot, as I told you, or give the entire path for every step. Okay, I think this is clear. So if you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer. But this will be a good exercise for you to run your whole genome sequencing or whole index, whole exome sequencing. Simply run cat_14.sh, which will view all the files like this. Okay. And then you can copy, paste in your command line in your respective folder. But if you want to give that particular file, then you need to give colon dot dot forward slash, because the files are present in your previous folder. Okay, so I'll be happy to take any questions you may have. Any questions, please? Yeah.
For converting the SAM file to the BAM file, is it necessary that SAM file should be created by HiSAT only, or it should be created by Bowtie only?
Not necessary. I told you about it too, and HiSAT as well. Not necessary. Anything SAM or BAM, you know, can be done. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, please.
When I ran the commands, my system did not recognize home/ngs that bit. Is there a possible reason why?
Can you just share me the screenshot? I think it should be done. Maybe if you can kindly share the screenshot in the group.
Okay, I did not take the screenshot, but okay. And another problem I had is there a way of saving what you did rather than going straight from the first code input?
Yeah. Unfortunately not. I mean, you wanted me to have a recording of this, is it?
No. Like, so when I was running the SAM command, my internet crashed, and so the entire thing halted. And when I had to like do it again, I had to type from the beginning. So I was wondering whether there was a way.
Yeah, unfortunately, yes. That's because you are connecting to a server from a remote location, so you need to start from scratch, you know, if the work has ended, you know, unfortunately. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Welcome. Do you have any questions, please? Yeah. So if there are no questions, I think I should thank you all, you know, for today. Please feel free to ask questions. You should, you know, not hesitate in asking any questions. Okay. I would like to thank you all, you know, for today. I'm sure, you know, most of you are all doing exercises, but please don't hesitate in asking any questions. Please. Please run that particular pipeline. You'll really love it. Okay, please. So thank you so much. So it's 8:17 and I'll, you know, say goodbye. So please join tomorrow. Okay. Thank you so much.